Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. I am Zach Peterson. I'm very happy you're all here today because we are going to be answering your questions from my videos on the Altium Academy channel. Let's go ahead and jump into it right now. This question comes from the Grounding in Ethernet with and without MagJacks video. Look at this guy on screen. I look like I'm like in my 20s or something. Anyways, let's go ahead and look at this first question. Thanks, Zach, for the great explanation. Can you please confirm this applies to MagJacks with PoE positive and negative as well? I have TVS diodes on the PN pairs, but I do not have ESD diodes to chassis ground. Are the ESD diodes to chassis ground recommended to have? So in short, yes, TVS diodes are important to have on signal lines, particularly when there is a risk of ESD getting onto those signals directly. Now, one of the reasons that we have ESD protection on an Ethernet interface or on any of the connectors or any of the other mechanical stuff that goes into Ethernet is because there is a galvanic isolation requirement as well as an ESD withstand requirement. Now, the galvanic isolation requirement also applies in the isolated DC-DC converter that you would use in PoE. And in fact, there are PoE-specific MagJacks that you can use if you're going to use PoE in your system. Now, if you're going to have a connection to chassis ground using a TVS diode, you just need to be aware that you need to actually have a chassis in your design in order to make that connection. Not all designs that have an Ethernet port have a metallized chassis ground. However, you can still have a chassis-like ground if you want, and you can have that placed as a guard ring around the edge of the PCB. If you divert ESD or any other kind of transient pulse into that guard ring around the edge of your PCB, it's going to keep it away from any of the components that are at risk of damage should ESD occur. So consider using that, especially in the case where you don't have a metallized chassis for your enclosure. Now, you can always do both. You can have a guard ring and you can have a metallized chassis, and you can basically connect the two together if you want. Your choice on how to do that. Of course, no matter what you do, make sure that you apply ESD testing on your device after you prototype it to make sure it's going to meet the Ethernet standard. Question number two comes from the Pi filter simulation and design video. And this particular question actually has nothing to do with Pi filters, but it does come from Altium Academy superfan Fetty Mockney. Fetty writes, will panelized boards be more cost-effective when manufacturing PCB, or should you always send a single PCB as it's more optimal? In the end, will the manufacturer panelize by themselves depending on the panel options available and then cut the PCBs to you and send the individual boards? And if that's the case, what is the point of panelizing and is it really cost-effective? Well, here's the deal with panelization. PCB materials are supplied in these large panels that have standard sizes. And so, of course, the cost to produce a board on one of those panel sizes is really the cost to produce an entire panel. So you can amortize that cost to produce an entire panel with all of that material across a large number of boards, essentially the total number of boards that you can fit into that panel. So because you're amortizing a fixed cost across a large number of units that you want to manufacture, you are dropping the price per unit. Pretty simple math there. So yes, it is always cost effective. Now you can then pay the manufacturer, usually just a little bit extra tooling charge or a little bit extra machine time charge to then cut out all of those PCBs and send them to you. But of course, you could also design the panel yourself so that you can do the depanelization on your own. That would then involve putting V-scores or mouse bites. The most common would be to place mouse bites. You can then just break off the rails you're on your own, file down the edge of the PCB so it's nice and smooth, and then you're finished. You have your fully assembled boards and they're ready to go into your product. This next question comes from the Flyback transformer design video. This was a really fun video because we got to go through the entire process of sizing a Flyback transformer, or I guess the coupled inductors that you would use in a flyback converter. The question asks, Zach, at 6 minutes 44 seconds, I use your calculated 2.57 amps output and then placed it back into the formula to verify or determine the original I secondary peak voltage. I get a value of 7.34 amps. Where did that value come from? Well, the thing that I'll say about that particular value is that it's really not so important except for sizing discrete semiconductors, and in this case, it would be important for sizing any rectifying diodes on the secondary side of that flyback transformer. The reason that's important is because those secondary side rectification diodes will have a peak pulsed current rating. And you want to make sure that you know what is the peak pulse current you can expect on the secondary side, and then you can size those diodes above that. If you don't do that, of course, you have a risk that those diodes will get hot and burn up, and then you don't have a functioning flyback converter anymore. Now, normally we just kind of ignore that peak secondary current value because what we're really designing for is an output current, and we're designing that output current based on the maximum input current that the switcher can withstand. The topology that's used in a flyback transformer is basically like an open drain type of circuit. The transistor switches on and off, it allows that drain current to flow, and then it's flowing through an inductor on the primary side, and that creates these peak pulses on the primary side, and you need to make sure that the snubber circuit on the primary side, as well as the switcher that you're using, can handle that current on the primary side. So that's often used to set a limit for what you can switch on the primary side. You can then design the transformer to give you your desired secondary side output, and that could be constrained by the peak pulse current of those secondary side rectifying diodes. Make sure to go back and watch that video again to learn more about that design approach, and you'll be able to see all of the calculations that are being referenced in this question. Once again, we have another question on one of the Altium Designer product team videos. If you are aware of the new features in the newest version of Altium Designer, there is a new auto shrinking feature that allows traces to automatically shrink down as they pass through obstacles. So that's a pretty useful feature, especially if you know you're going to be doing something like neck down into a BGA. You can set that up without having to design a special design rule. The question asks, doesn't impedance change in the two ear areas, for example, going from 8 mil to 4 mil and then from 4 mil to 8 mil? Is this desirable? Well, the answer is yes, the characteristic impedance does change along that transition between those two widths. But the determination of whether this is actually a problem for signal integrity really depends on the channel bandwidth that you need for that connection with that trace. So that channel bandwidth in this example would be determined by the interface that is on those two components. Again, different high-speed interfaces need different channel bandwidths in order for a signal to transfer enough power between two components to function properly and then be able to recover a logic level from that signal. When channel bandwidths get very high, you can only tolerate very short sections where the trace width shrinks down to that 4 mil value shown in the video. So, again, this is another instance where input impedance is really a very important metric for PCB designers to understand, especially if you're going to be working on high-speed digital interfaces. This next question is less of a question and more of a snarky comment, but we'll take a look at it anyways. This comes from the video or the podcast episode that we did with Reinhard Neureiter, CEO of Denpaflux. The comment slash question says, this is exactly like AutoRoute. Would you buy a used car from it? Haha, laughing emoji. No, this is not like AutoRoute because the tool that's being shown in this podcast episode is actually an EMI analyzer that uses AI to give you recommendations for how your PCB layout should change. Now, I think this is actually a really great use case for AI in PCB design. It's not trying to AutoRoute your board, it's not trying to remove the designer from the process or do any sort of auto placements or anything like that. It's really just giving you intelligent recommendations for simple things you can do to improve your design so that you overcome EMI problems that are well known to occur from PCB layout mistakes. So that's a really useful use case for AI. Highly recommend you go check out that podcast episode to learn more, because there are going to be a lot more tools like this coming out on the horizon. And I think it's great for designers to understand what the capabilities are today and what they are likely to be in the future. This next comment comes from one of the design review videos. In this 1 minute design review, Julian Hoyos uses a 5-volt to 3.6 volt step down voltage regulator, and then immediately proceeds to step that 3.6 volts down to 3.3 volts using a diode. The comment here also comes from Robogot, who also left the previous two comments slash questions. And the comment here says, I fear the 3.6 volts is used to account for the forward voltage drop of the protection diode and then create the 3.3 volts. Not really a nice solution. Of course, it's current dependent, etc. I actually 100% agree with this. I don't understand why you wouldn't just take the 5 volts and step it down directly to 3.3 volts instead of going to 3.6 volts and then using a diode to reach the 3.3 volts. Doesn't make sense to me either. The only possibility I can see with this is that there is some reverse protection that's being applied here on that 3.3 volt rail, but then I would have expected another O-ring diode somewhere else for another connection onto that 3.3 volt rail, and we just don't see that anywhere in the design. So the takeaway here is this: if you want to get to 3.3 volts, don't use an intermediate voltage like 3.6 volts and then step that down another 0.3 volts with a diode. Just use a voltage regulator to go from 5 volts directly to 3.3 volts. This next question comes from one of our 1 minute design reviews for a board submitted by Vincent Nguyen. And in this particular design review, we of course had placement of ferrite beads. The comment here says, thanks for the info. I searched and tried to learn about ferrite beads and why they are not suitable for high current paths. Could not find any info was the original question. And of course, this has been edited a couple weeks ago. Now, my response to this is very simple. Ferrite beads are actually very good for blocking noise from a DC load. So for example, if you have a DC load and you know you're gonna have some AC noise that could then reach that DC load, the ferrite bead is very good for blocking that AC noise. It's also very good for blocking high frequency AC noise from a low frequency AC load that only needs to draw power at very low frequencies, as long as the ferrite is below the saturation current. What ferrites are not good for is trying to block noise from an AC load when you also need to deliver power in the bandwidth where the ferrite bead is blocking. So you can't put a blocking element and then also try to deliver power within the same frequency range where the blocking element is filtering out power. Doesn't make any sense, right? But that is one of the biggest mistakes regarding the use of ferrites. So I've said this many times, you can watch some of the other Q&A videos that we've done, you can watch some of the videos on Altium Academy, and you can watch our expert opinions on ferrites video on the Altium Academy channel. I think that one really sums up the massively incorrect usage of ferrite beads that is most common in PCB design. And this last question comes from this same 1 minute design review video. This question says, I have heard you say this many times with little explanation. I would love to see a dedicated video of why and what to do instead. Well, good thing for you, I replied in a comment with a link to our expert opinions on ferrite beads video. And that's the one I was referencing in the previous question. Make sure to check out the link in the description. You'll see a link to that expert opinions on ferrites video. And I think it's really great for anybody who wants to use ferrites in a PCB to first watch that video and learn what not to do with ferrite beads. It's a great way to avoid some of the common mistakes that engineers all over the world are making every single day. Thanks for watching this video, everybody. We love getting your comments and questions over on the Altium Academy channel. And I would love to do an individual response video for every question, but unfortunately, I just can't do it. So make sure to go subscribe to Altium Academy. Leave any comments or questions over on the Altium Academy channel. And of course, I will go ahead and answer those comments and questions here on my channel in these videos. Make sure to subscribe to my channel and you'll see more of these videos come out soon. Thanks, everybody.